been disowned. Come join our circle and turn off your phones. Whoever you are, whomever you love, however you came to be in this community, you are welcome here. You are welcome here. If you are running, you've got the right to seek sanctuary, guided by the light. That calling, come join the fight. Marching for justice, candles lit in the night. Whoever you are, whomever you love, however you came to be in this community, you are well.
Please stand or remain standing and join us in singing Lean On Me.
Sometimes in our lives, we all have pain. We all have sorrow, but if you are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow. Lean on me when you're not strong. I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. Please swallow your pride. If I have things you need to borrow, for no one can fill those of your needs that you won't let show. You just call me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you'll understand. We all need somebody to lean on me. When you're not strong, I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on.
And now let's remain standing and join in the welcome song, please.
Welcome into this place. Welcome into this open vessel. You desire to abide in
and the praises of your people. So we lift our hands and we lift our hearts as we offer up this praise unto your name. Welcome into this place. Welcome into this open vessel. You desire to abide in the praises of your people. So we lift our hands and we lift our hearts as we offer up this praise unto your name. Your name. Please take a moment and respectfully greet the Spirit of Christ and the beautiful people all around you.
I was born in 1958, and when I was growing up, I remember being in grade school, and this song right here was everywhere. It was written by Bob Dylan and made famous by Peter, Paul, and Mary. They even played it at the March on Washington when Martin Luther King spoke, when he had that did his famous I Have a Dream speech. If you ever go to the Lincoln Memorial, it's carved right there in the marble, I Have a Dream.
Before you call him a man, how many seas must a white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? How many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
How many years can a mountain exist before it's washed to the sea? How many years can some people exist before they're allowed to be free? How many times can a man turn his head, pretend that he just doesn't see? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
How many times must a man look up before he sees the sky? How many ears must one man have before he can hear people cry? How many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have cried? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is my friend, is blowing in the wind.
answer is blowing in the wind.
Wonderful. Well, officially, I want to welcome everybody to our 11 o'clock service, especially those who are connecting online right now. Thank you for keeping us company and joining in. Love that opening welcome song. I would like to make it like a opening statement. Welcome you, whoever you are, whomever you love, however you came to be in this community. You are welcome here. So please know that. Whether it might be your first time here, one of your first few times, or you've been coming here for years, know that you are truly, truly welcome. Have some announcements like every Sunday. We'd like to start by letting everybody know that we are continuing to pick up, accept people who go by and get a tag. As you know, 30 kids from our community have been removed from their homes, and every year we bring gifts to them to make different meaningful Christmas. So we ask you to stop by the counter either today, well, last week and today, and then bring your gifts next Sunday and December 1st. Dr. Marsha Walters is back like every month, and today at 1:30, she will be doing another workshop on intuition upgrade. And based on what she said in our Tuesday class, it's gonna be really experiential. So I'm sure that it's gonna be another level of intuition after taking the class. Then my third but last announcement today, as you know, I've been almost 8 years here in the Raleigh area, seventh of which I have served as your associate minister. And it's been really a happy time. The only thing, when Christmas time comes along, I really get very nostalgic, because in Puerto Rico, we have big, big Christmas traditions like the parranda, where we come together to sing, to dance, and we do that through the night, through the early morning hours. And it's been four times that I've had this event, and it's coming back. So I want to say thank you for your support in allowing me to have this and share this tradition with me. And today I'm gonna do the announcement, but I'm gonna ask you to do the announcement with me. And the way we're gonna do it is that we're gonna start playing some of that Puerto Rican Christmas music. And then as I start clapping, you're gonna clap with me, and then I'll do the announcement. Would you do that with me? Okay, bring it on. Okay, come on. So Friday, December 6th at 7 p.m., music, fun, fellowship, community, we're coming together. Bring that Latino out in you and have a great, great time. Tickets are available today at the lobby and online, and this time will be for a good cause. Remember, Parrandon 2019, yay! You guys were great. Let's do that like last year. We had a choo-choo train all over. We had like 80 people at the same time. It was wonderful, so anyways. And now I have to come back to boys. So I'm gonna ask you to please start joining us in singing, Sure to the Presence. Let me take a deep breath so I calm myself down, and you too, as we start preparing for our prayer chaplain's prayer and our meditation. So bring it on, Tim.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel God's mighty power and God's grace. There's a holy hush around us. see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Let us pray. Sweet, invisible, loving Spirit, we recognize and feel you in our hearts. You've never gone away, but we take a moment to intentionally turn our thoughts, our feelings, all that we are, so that we can be the most fullest expression of you now. And as we turn our attention there to who we truly are, we recognize the intentions of the names that have been placed in this prayer box. For whatever the challenge, the impediment, the obstacle, the opportunity, we bring Christ's love and healing presence, which is in our hearts, which is in the hearts of those names that have been placed in this box, more fully present, to surround, to hold, to hug, and to embrace all that is, and especially the names that have been placed in the prayer box. For it is in this Christ presence that all healing begins and ends. We are so grateful for the opportunity to come together, to support each other in this way, and for this special time where we can celebrate our life in love, in community, and in Christ's presence. Can we see past the impediment to where the blessing exists? Can we take it even a step further and see and feel the blessing, even in the tears and the pain as they're happening? We breathe into this place. We accept our circumstances, and we release all that holds us back from our true selves. And so it is. Amen.
We are holy.
As we begin to meditate, let us adjust the body. Let your bodies find a comfortable way to sit. And begin to inhabit the body by paying attention to the breath. So the body becomes the object of our attention for a moment, not our thoughts about the future or the past. We speculate on nothing, we pay attention to the breath. As we come into the body, let us also come into the heart. Let's begin to feel our hearts, breathe our hearts, energize our hearts. As you begin to feel into your heart, then let us be a gift to everyone here and send some of that love in all directions to everyone in this room that we might be nourished by your presence. Become a source of love and acceptance. As that becomes a shared experience, we begin to float in this sea of love, this mutual acceptance, this comradeship of mariners on a journey. The journey to awaken. Not only to our deepest and most profound nature, but also to the joys of life. So for a few minutes, as we sit together, contemplate the arc of your life, the ups, the downs, the wins, the losses, the success and the disappointments. See it not as though those were the most important thing, but that your life, your unfolding, is the most important thing. Your being, your soul, its journey through this life, is what we're trying to catch in this reflection. The wins and losses are waypoints. Find the traveler, and let us celebrate the traveler as we sit together in holy silence. Thank you.
this day our daily bread. You said you would supply all my needs according to your riches. I have but to ask, and I shall receive. To go from here and share this love you gave to me, to show someone who's lost and help them find their way, the way to truth and faith, so they can be free like me, free like me. Lord, we are your love. Lord, we are your peace. Lord, we are your joy this day. This
day. So we're here today. I want to celebrate your life from here, from this stage, and I'd like you to celebrate it from where you sit. The trick often is that as we lose, and we often lose, is that we then think there's something less about us. But I'd like to make the case today that losing is part of the winning, and without your losses, which seem to be necessary, you can never become the person you have become. So let me start with a story. I was 25 years old. I had been a river guide for some years at that point, and I was peaking physically. We were in South America. We had been doing commercial river trips in Chile on a very hard river called the Biobío, and we decided we would go and find another river in Chile to add to the potential river trips that we could do commercial trips on. So a few hardy men and one woman go to Bariloche, Chile, in the Andes, on the east side of the Andes, to float this river that crosses the Andes somehow and ends up in the Pacific Ocean. It should have been our first clue. It's called manso, which means tame, but that was kind of like the joke. So we get on this river, all we have is a road map, and we're trying to look at the altitudes on this road map, and literally a road map, not a topo map. It had some elevations for a lake that we thought it was coming from, and that would actually tell us that we thought we could do it in about 3 days. So we packed food for 3 days. We thought, well, maybe it would take six, but we could stretch it. It wouldn't hurt us to stretch it. It turns out it took us 10 days to do this. It was a hard river. First, it started off really slow, just like we thought. It went through bushes, and we had to part the trees sometimes to get through it. Like nothing much was happening. But by the second day, the river had narrowed, and the walls had steepened, and now the trees, maybe 30 feet above our head, would cross their branches because the canyon was so narrow and so steep. And then it started to drop really fast. And as it picked up in its dropping, I have one picture that I remember quite distinctly being there. We were shoving off and down, not just like floating around, but shoving off and down, not quite a waterfall, but not far from it, and going around a blind corner. Now, it would only do that because I'm 25, right? But we did it. We made it. We made it around that, and it unfolded. We continued to do that. We had some very difficult days of running rivers the river that was difficult in itself, but then it also sometimes would just choke off to where we wouldn't dare run it. So we would then portage, and we portaged we had two rafts, and sometimes we would take the rafts and we'd go over boulders about as tall as this to the balcony. And so we would, to get up over the boulders, we would tilt the boat up and then we'd climb up the boat, get on top of the rock, then pull the boat or the boulder up, the boat over the boulder to the next one, drop it down, row across the river, and repeat. And anyway, we made it. Three of us almost died, but nobody died, and nobody was particularly injured or anything, and we did lose a little weight, but not a lot, considering. We had a professional fisherman on the trip, and because this river was seldom run, there were tons of fish, and I remember fishing myself and throwing a line, and a little fish, maybe this big, would try to get on it. I'd pull it out of that fish's mouth before he could bite it, so a bigger one could bite it. And it was on those trout that we really survived, essentially, for the next few days. I could go on about this story because it's one of those stories that became legendary in the river running world, at least among the people that I worked with who were into running international river trips. So we had this fantastic story, all because we had faced adversity. And had it been the manso, meaning tame in Spanish, had it been manso, we would have no story, we would have forgotten it. There's a river we did the next year, which was manso, it wasn't the same, wasn't really named that, but it was that. And we were really disappointed, you know, went so easily. So the thing about your life, especially almost everybody, remembers their victories that were difficult, not the ones that were easy, right? Do you remember breakfast? I mean, 2 days later, if you could, I mean, unless you didn't have breakfast for a long time, and then you finally got it. I remember the last breakfast of this river trip, we called it a dingo breakfast, which was a drink of water and a look around. And the following day, I remember that breakfast as well, because we had come to a farm and there were an apple orchard there. Unfortunately, the apples weren't completely ripe, but that's what we had to eat. So we ate them until we felt sick. So I remember that one too. But most of the times you don't remember your breakfast because it came so easily, was not important. And like everything else in your life, if you had to work at it, it's better, it seems to have more meaning for us. And so adversity or difficulty is really the beginning of a great story. I had a friend who used to say, no scar, no story. So if you didn't have a hard time somewhere, you got nothing to brag about now. Look at almost every politician running for president on the Democratic side. I started out a poor white child. Right? Something like that. And I became who I am today through adversity, right? Just part of the way we recognize the common struggle of life. Life is difficult. And I think that's what the Buddha said when he said life is suffering. He said life is difficult. It's not easy to get through life. He actually was saying something different. But he said largely the reason we think it's difficult is because we complain about it, which is true. Do you know that the difference between fear and excitement is only the way you name what's happening to you physiologically? That physiologically, your heart speeds up, your palms get sweaty, your mouth may get dry, you have a kind of a queasiness in the belly. Some people call it excitement, some people call it fear, right? It's just a matter of interpretation. Nothing is but what we say it's so. So that if you have these challenges in life, and most of us still do have some, if you have these challenges in life, sometimes if we could just reframe it, and that's what I'm trying to do today, reframe it. If you can reframe it, it becomes a better journey. It becomes a better, you know, because you could imagine if my mother, instead of telling me never to do river trips like that, had commanded me to do river trips like that, I would think she was trying to kill me. I would feel oppressed. It would be a burden on my soul that my mother had sent me off to do this. But if I sent myself out there, I, of course, I never told her I was doing this. I had a very different experience, right? How many of us are whining about things that if we had chosen to do them, we would not be whining about today? Right? It's in your mind, much of it. Much of the suffering we have is what's in us, not what's out there. So, there's that. And I'd like to talk about the two stages of life, essentially, because there is the way we, in, the meaning of the difficulties can change with a growing wisdom of age. And like when I was in my 20, when I was 25 and this was happening, all this was, these were challenges to prove myself to myself and to the world, right? A big piece of being in your 20s, 30s, and even 40s, and sometimes even longer, is to prove yourself to the world that you have made it up money, you have arrived, you have done something worthy, you are a success in some way. We are, and we meet the challenges of life to fulfill those requirements. It seems those requirements are fundamental to being a human being. We must feel like we have done something to accomplish it. And if we don't, we have a deficit. So I'm not saying these challenges are not important, but when you get older, when you become far enough down the road that you can look back over a longer series of changes, when you get there, you realize that you would not be the person you are today had you not had those challenges. And some of those challenges are you failed. You fell flat on your face. You were defeated. You were betrayed. You were embarrassed. You lost everything in the stock market. I think I've done all of those. And many other things. Maybe you lost your health, whatever. But they become fundamental for you becoming who you have become today, because your response to those difficulties, those adversity, is what made you who you are today. And part of what it made you, possibly, is more humble. Part of what it made you is more able to see in the suffering of others your own suffering, and you recognize, hey, that person, me, we are the same. We are not so separate. I'm not like building a tower of my own success of which you will never scale. No, I've crumbled and I'm down on the ground with you, and we are the same. We all share this vulnerability to life changing, sometimes underneath our feet, sometimes coming from outside, sometimes directly from inside. One of the things I've noticed about my life, and I still hold this to be true, is no one's ever done anything to me that I didn't do to myself. You can't beat me to the punch. Right? Any problem I've ever had, I did it. And maybe I'm just lucky. And maybe you're not as lucky as I am. But I can tell you, that's the truth for me. It still is. All my problems are my problems. I did them. That being the case, it's not so bad, because I realize at this point that if I had not caused myself trouble, I would not be the person I am, right? Not that I'm perfect or great, it's just that this is how it is unfolding for me. I stumble, and in stumbling, I become wiser somehow. I make huge mistakes, and somehow I become wiser. I lose pitifully. I embarrass myself in front of other people, and that's how I become who I am becoming. Is that right? Is that not true for you? Are you not stumbling and growing through that process? Is that not just the way it is? Isn't it what you, haven't you seen it at least in your friends? Maybe you are in the midst of it right now, to where you cannot see outside the darkness of the loss that's going on right now. But in your friends, you can at least see it. Hey, aren't you better for having that happen? We're like that. We're just, it's the nature of the human experience. Many of you have heard of Joseph Campbell. Joseph Campbell wrote the book, The Hero with a Thousand Faces. The Hero with a Thousand Faces says essentially this: there's one story in life. One, the hero's journey. This one story is modulated and changed from different cultures, and it's, and it comes in many forms, but it's always the same story. If you break it down, it's essentially this. There you are, and something draws you out of your normal life. You go to a far country, You have an experience. You think you're there to defeat somebody. And in the end, what happens is that you are changed. And you being changed, you come back and bring that revelation of yourself to the community that you were in before. And that's your return journey home. This is the hero's journey, or heroine, depending if you, which side of that you're on. Hero or heroine, that's your journey. We generally are defeated in this game of life. We're defeated into success. We lose into success. Great story around that, of course, is the Odyssey. Homer writes this Odyssey, the Odyssey, I can't remember when it was written. It was long before Jesus was, story of Jesus. But if you think of Jesus, it's the same story in a certain sense. Well, quite different in many ways, but the story of Jesus. Jesus, the big loser of all time, right? Comes in, heals the sick, preaches good news to the poor, and gets strung up for it. Right? He's the biggest loser of all time, and yet turns out to be the biggest winner of all time. Right? This is myth as much as it is fact, meaning it is universal as much as it is particular, the story of Jesus. The story of Jesus is simply this: you will be crucified, and out of your crucifixion will come your greatest gift to the world. So how many of you have been betrayed by your spouse, lied to, told stories, people have told stories about you that were even were not true, and unfortunately some of them which were true, which ruined your reputation? How many of you had that? Nobody? Just me? It's okay. It makes us an open experience. It opens our heart to the experience of life. At 25, I don't think anybody had ever betrayed me, ever done me wrong. And quite frankly, I don't think I'd done that many people wrong myself yet. But as time would go on, both those things would happen. And it would take me down, and I would have to come back up. But that's the value of life, is that you get to go through this cycle. And sometimes it feels just like you're crossing a boulder that you have to throw a boat over to get tall enough to get over it. Sometimes it's really difficult. And when you're in those situations, some things really help. And these are the things that helped us on the river trip and help you in your life. These are a couple, you probably have others, but one of which is have friends. Have people with you on the journey. Now, I've talked to Mimi, who's the pastoral care coordinator here, and Anna, who does a lot of pastoral care work here. We were talking about how people disappear when they get in trouble from this church. Their life is going okay, and then it starts to fall apart, which it does, right? And people go, I don't know what they're thinking, but I'll tell you what I'm thinking. You should stick here where you have friends, because you need us then. You don't have to just be a hero. You don't have to be the one who always comes in and saves everybody. Every once in a while, you just come in, you're broken. And most of us did come here because we got broken somewhere before, right? You didn't come here because you were born into this tradition. You came here because you were looking depth and meaning in your life anyway. So now that you're in the process of finding depth and meaning in your life, don't leave. Don't leave just because you're divorcing or that you're ill or that you've lost your job or whatever it is. This is what this is. It's a place for us to journey together, not a place to always win, and certainly not a place to always lose. We don't like losing. I don't like losing at all. Ask my dear friends. They know. But this process of going through life, you need friends. I would have never made it down that river. You won't make it through life very easily without them. Take advantage of that. Take advantage of this community. Contribute also your own into the community. That is another way to heal, to not be at effect of all that's around you. So just because it's happening to you and bad things are happening to you doesn't mean you can't contribute. You don't have to wait till you're perfect to give. You can give from wherever you are. Everybody could use a smile, even if you're grimacing in the process. Everybody's heart could use some love. If yours is broken, you're probably right on the edge of being the biggest fountain you've ever been. The heart, when it's broken, breaks open. So you have something to give. So not only receive, but give. And that giving will give you strength. It will. So remember that. And don't run from your friends when things go bad. And don't run from your friends when things go bad for them. You don't have to be a martyr on either side of that one. Now back to the journey. So we lose, and we grow out of it, and we become more, and then we lose, and we come out of it, and we become more. Ultimately, we will lose everything we have ever gained. So you know, in the Bible it says, what would it profit a man if he got the whole world but lost his soul? So the story there really is that this story is about your soul. This journey, this life journey, which has its ups and downs, is not about winning. It's about your soul's journey to its own unfolding and becoming. That's what we're really here for. We're not here just to win. And God knows I want to win. But it's not just about that. It's not just about being rich. And Lord knows I want to be rich, right? It's not just about being the prettiest one in the room, which I've given up on, but it's your journey. It's your heart's or your soul's journey through this life. And like any journey, it has hills and valleys. It has rivers to cross. It's complex. And it makes you a bigger person to have had those challenges. And the adversity of life begins to make you richer. It's like a wine which has some complexity to it. You are the most important thing. Your soul, you, the deeper you, is the most important thing in your life, not the things on the surface. It's easy to be forgetful of that. And because our culture, our American culture, is so youth-oriented, is so success-oriented, fame-oriented, power-oriented, it tends to diminish the inner life and only ask, so how much did you make last year? But that's not really that great a question if you're on the second half of life and you're trying to become the greatest soul you can be. That's just a distraction to some degree. But our culture hasn't really caught on generally to the depth of life. We're still on the surface. We're still a young adolescent. We're actually a bad adolescent culture right now, aren't we? We're kind of like silly in our culture. And we believe in bombastic things might be better than peace. So we have a ways to go. But we don't have to be the last ones to get there. Let us be the first ones. Let us realize that we are really about something more than our outward success. We're about our inward growth. And I ask you to win every chance you can, because your losses will come without any effort at all. You don't have to worry about that. Win as often as you can. You're going to lose anyway. Your losses will have their day, and you'll have your growth from that. It'll come naturally. You don't have to discount yourself. Become all you can be in every stage of your life, but realize that really the deeper thing, the thing that's really happening, is you're becoming something that only through the vicissitudes of life could you get there, not just from a steady victory. It's okay. I would like it to be different too, yes. Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you rewrite the script where you just go on and on, happily ever after? That's why they stopped the, Disney stops the fairy tale at that point. They don't carry it on because, well, it just carries on, you know? It's like, so you take Sleeping Beauty. Sleeping Beauty sleeps for 100 years before she can recognize the kiss of a prince. Think of that. Odysseus takes 10 years to get home from the Trojan Wars. 10 years. It's 20 years total from the time he left. The only thing that recognizes him when he gets home, he looks so different, is his dog. Must have been a bionic dog, some 20-year-old dog. But anyway, the dog recognizes him, but nobody else does. His wife is... Son's not too clear, he's got a little idea, but we will be different. In the 20 years from now, we will all be different. Let's hope so. Let's not be the same person 20 years from now that we are today. I know for some of us, that's not a problem. We won't be here. But you catch the drift. I think, I'll give you one other clue. I think, besides having friends, giving and receiving in those friendships that help on the journey, one more thing. This is about the heart, really. That essentially, the mind calculates, plans, plots, tries to navigate without loss. And the heart, which is not so calculating, not able to plan and plot, but receives and experiences and digests what's happening. The heart converts experience into a knowing of some sort. So if you really want to become a swift traveler through these ups and downs, then be able to access the heart so that the heart can do the work that it's designed to do. You know, sometimes we do this meditation practice here called Tonglen, T-O-N-G-L-E-N. It's from the Tibetan, Tonglen. Breathe in suffering, breathe out love. Breathe in suffering, and not too much, and breathe out love. You can do it for your own life. When you're suffering, do not run from it. You breathe in the suffering, and you breathe out love. Do not breathe in all your suffering all at once. Do not try to be a hero in this journey at this point. Just breathe in the suffering and breathe out love, and you transform, you transmute that which is difficult into that which is healing and growing. So breathe in your own suffering and breathe out love. Have friends. Breathe in their suffering. Breathe out love to them. Let them breathe in your suffering and breathe out love. Take your own suffering and breathe it in and breathe out love. We transform things not by running from them, but by engaging them deeply. We are here for our soul, not for the surface. Let us pray. As we begin, we might as well begin with feeling where we are right now. Let the mind be awake to your suffering, to your joys, to your successes, your failures, your becoming, your losing. Whatever's happening, be alert. perhaps several things at once. Invite yourself to succeed in every place you're losing at this moment, but also be willing to convert that suffering, the loss, into victory. The Saint Paul says, I die daily. The little dies. The big inside you never dies. You are becoming your true self. And your mistakes are part of the journey. Your betrayals, your losses are part of the journey. Big heart, big courage, big transformation. We did not come into this life that we might stay the same. We came into this life that we might become a fuller version of who we really are. You are a blessing in your own way, just as you're traveling it today. You are a better version every day. You are awakening every day. Your soul is on its way. And so it is. Amen. Couple of things I just want to say. You know, we have Thanksgiving coming fairly quickly now, and if you have no place that you would rather be, there are 100 people here waiting for your company and would love to share a potluck with you here at 2 o'clock on Thanksgiving Day. Also, we have a musical, I guess it's mostly musical, but other things happen also. Thing open mic on Thursday nights, the third Thursday of the month, every month so far. Keep coming. It's really fun. I mean, I must say it's a fun thing to do. One of the things we've really tried to do here in this last year is to expand the amount of social things we do, because one of the things I'm sure that happens when you come here is that you're hoping to find friends and that you can trust and lean into. And so we open these doors up more often for that, and I invite you to take advantage of that as well. One of the things we also have here is a board. I have the board president here, and he's here to tell me how great I am, but I wish that was the case. He's here to talk to you, so thanks, Hank.
And before I hand the mic over to Hank, I just want to say it's my pleasure to serve with such a great board president. He's going to be rolling off, and we need 2 new board members, so if you're interested, ruben.schuler@unitytriangle.org. Send me an email. Let Hank know, any member of the board. Okay? So thank you.
Thank you. Ruben is a board member that's charged with organizing the leadership selection ministry, which is how we create sort of an electoral college for the new board members. So Ruben, R-E-U-B-E-N. There we go. Thank you. November, right? Getting cold, cool, cold? Nah. I moved here from Vermont. I have friends in Vermont. I talk to them regularly just to get the contrast of what they're going through and what we're going through. They're scraping ice and snow off their windshield and wearing boots and wool, and they're having a harder time than we are. And tomorrow marks 30 days to the day that I pulled up to be with Beth. 30 years to the day. 30 years. I had a Toyota van and some tools and a U-Haul trailer with a guitar and an amplifier and a few odds and ends, and that was it. It has all been a role since then, settling into Raleigh and finding unity. So right away, we started into Unity Church 2 years after we got together. We had a little boy, and he's a 27-year-old guy with a unity spirit. The Unity Youth Program was wonderful for him, for his development, and he's a better person because of it. And so I've kind of stepped in and stepped in and stepped in, and this is my third year of being on the board. I love it because this is this primary spiritual center for the triangle. And this particular month is the month in which we have the challenge match. The matching challenge was offered up in October, where we had an angel chunk of money to match, to double any gift of $500 or $1,000. And I am extremely pleased with the response to that. So thank you. Thank you, everyone. I mentioned to someone that we exceeded the actual angel matching fund, and I had an anonymous donor step up last week with an additional big chunk. So there's two more weeks to stretch our matching challenge for you to participate in that. The contributions this year, 2019, are up, greater than our budget and greater than last year. And I mentioned at the congregational meeting or the homecoming meeting that the expenses are up. So the reason that we're doing the match is that property owner's dues increased this year, and our principal on our loan payment makes this a more expensive year. So our operating expenses are up. But your gifts are up, and I thank you very much for that. Remember when we did we needed a piano a couple of years ago, and everybody said, yeah, oh, yeah, if that's what it takes, we'll put some money in, and we had checks written within weeks to pay for that piano. People bought keys. So in a similar way, you've stepped up with this challenge, and I want to thank you all for that. Right now, we're going to ask for your contribution. We're going to look up on the monitor and see what we're supposed to say when we hold our gifts in our hands together. Divine love as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. The blue pen. Do y'all know about the blue pen? If you have donated towards the challenge and you have your pen, maybe you could hand it to me because mine has disappeared. But the blue pen is so cool. This is your gift of a check of $500 or $1,000. Yeah, this is woo. This is definitely woo, and this could be yours. If you have given and haven't received this, get one from the welcome desk, and if you haven't given, this will be the motivation. Not to mention the self-approval of supporting this ministry. Thank you.
Yes, church is a great place to meet people. I met these two at coffee hour.
We are the keepers of the flame, steady light that shines, showing us the way. We are the keepers of the flame, pushing back the darkness in our world today. Ooh.
We believe that simple acts of kindness can build a bridge across the river wide, standing up to those who have been blinded to the good that we all have inside.
You can see our beacon from afar. It's powered by the passion in our hearts. We are the keepers of the flame. steady light that shines, showing us the way. We are the keepers of the flame, pushing back the darkness in our world today. Rising up together in a choir. We won't put you down or scorn your choices. We will lift you up and take you high. You can see our beacon from afar. It's powered by the passion in our hearts. We are the keepers of the flame, steady light that shines, showing us the way. We are the keepers of the flame, pushing back the darkness in our world today.
Ooh. Keep going.
Marching, banners held high, moving forward from this holy ground. Speaking truth to power won't be denied, won't be stopped, won't be shouted down.
You can see our beacon from afar. It's powered by the passion in our hearts. We are the keepers of the flame, steady light that shines, showing us the way. We are the keepers of the flame, pushing back the darkness in our world today. Pushing back the darkness in our world today. Pushing back the darkness in our world today.
Hey, I'm Janice, Youth Director, and I have great news. We made blessing bags, as you probably heard. Guess how many we made? 245, and we packaged everything. And all the kids, we blessed everything. We held hands and blessed everything, and all the recipients and all the givers. And we got to work, and we did it. 245, that's awesome. So thank you for your generosity.
So now we're going to give a blessing to the kids. And we want to take this in as we say it to them. So let's say it together. If you want to be happy, practice kindness. We bless you as you express love to yourself and others. Now, don't hold hands. We're going to sing the peace song and clap at the same time.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, a peace that was meant to be, with God as creator, family all are we. Let me walk with my family in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my joyful vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us.
I am the love of God.
The power of God protects us.
I am the power of God.
The presence of God watches over us.
I am the presence of God.
Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. See you next week. Thank you.